Hi, I'm Jeff Mucklin, crew member of the Josiah White II Canal Boat, and I'll be continuing Adventures Aloud by reading chapters 17 and 18 from Tales of the Towpath. When we last left Finn on Friday, he and his new friend and possible relative, John Gorman, were headed for the Switchback Railroad. Let's join them now. Chapter 17, A Wonderful Ride. My day on the Switchback with John Gorman was one of the most memorable days of my life. I remember every detail. John took me up Susquehanna Street to Broadway, a narrow road that followed Ma Chunk Creek into the mountains west of town. I looked behind me across the Lehigh River and marveled at the size of a round mountain that rose above the canal. "That's Bear Mountain," John said. "That's what Ma Chunk means in Indian language. People say an Indian warrior named Onoko killed a sleeping bear there. Then he and his wife, Wanoa, were killed by a great spirit that wanted revenge for the bear. I like stories like that. That town at the bottom of Bear Mountain is East Ma Chunk. You'll have a better view of it soon." We started climbing a hill and walked past a large house that John said was once owned by a man named Josiah White. John told me that Mr. White designed the Lehigh Canal and a lot of other things, including the Switchback. "There's the ticket house," John said, as we approached a small building further up the hill. "That's where we get on the Switchback. The men there know me. All we have to do is climb into one of the empty coal cars and wait for the Barney car to start things off." I had never done anything quite so adventurous. Traveling on the Belfast Queen and sitting in a lumber camp wagon seemed ordinary compared to what I was about to do. John was right. I did have a good view of East Ma Chunk and Bear Mountain from the ticket house, but I had an even better view of a mountain looming to my left. It made Bear Mountain look downright puny. Right smack in the middle of it was the Switchback Railroad. It went almost straight up. I felt a certain queasiness in my stomach. "What do you think of that, Finn?" John asked me. I didn't answer. "Finn," I said, "what do you think of the Switchback?" "Do we have to go up that mountain?" I asked, already knowing the answer. "Sure, that's one of the best parts," John said. "That's Mount Pisgah, the tallest mountain around these parts. Then a while later, we go up Mount Jefferson. That's near my home in Summit Hill." "Are you certain this is safe?" I asked. "Those railroad paths are pretty steep. What if the car doesn't make it or starts to slide backwards?" "The cars can't slide backwards," John said. "They built cat steps to prevent that. Once we start going up, we won't stop until we reach the engine house at the top. See it up there? Then we glide all the way down to Mount Jefferson. It's about 6 miles. And Finn, those paths are called tracks. They're railroad tracks. Look, Finn, here comes the Barney car. Let's get ready to go. Climb into the front car." I looked behind me and saw a strange-looking wooden car coming out of an underground pit. It had two wide iron straps attached to the front and was being pulled up by a set of narrow iron rails. Ahead of it was a line of 8 empty coal cars. "Come on, Finn, jump in," John urged me. "Once the Barney touches the last car in the line, we'll start to go up the mountain." "What's pulling the Barney car?" I asked John as I climbed into the front coal car. "There's a big steam engine in the house at the top of the mountain," he replied. "It powers a big wheel that holds the Barney car's iron straps. When the wheel turns, it rolls up the straps and pulls the Barney up the mountain. Then the Barney pushes all the cars in front of it up the mountain. I've heard the engine is as powerful as 90 horses. All of a sudden, I felt our car begin to move. I gripped the sides until my knuckles turned white. Then I closed my eyes. John looked at me and started laughing. "Finn," he said, "your name is Gorman. If you and I are related, then I know you're brave. Open your eyes and enjoy the ride." "All right," I said, "I will." And from that moment on, I decided I was going to have fun no matter how scary the ride became. Here's a illustration of them riding across a gorge, and you can see somebody waving their arms at the front. Somebody's having a good time. I looked behind us and saw a man in the coal car at the back of the line. "He operates the brakes when we go downhill," John said. "I see it's Mr. Sherman today. He lets the cars go faster than most brakemen." Good gracious, I thought. Just my luck. The ride up Mount Pisgah was a real treat. I looked all around as we climbed. Behind us were the Lehigh River and the canal. The canal boats looked tiny from the mountain, and the town's buildings looked like little wooden toys. We kept climbing until I could hear the engine working inside the engine house. I was amazed at how easily it pulled us up the hill. The top half of the engine house was built in an arch over the tracks. As we passed through, I felt like I was on top of the world. We were higher than anything else. I could see miles and miles in any direction. "This is wonderful," I shouted to John. "Where do we go next?" "We go downhill to Mount Jefferson," he said. "Look in front of you. We're already over the trestle." A gorge in the mountain loomed in front of us. It was about 40 feet deep and more than 200 feet wide. Built over it was a wooden trestle that carried the switchback. "Will it hold us?" I asked. John? He just laughed. If the trestle cracked, we were goners. I held my breath as we went over and refused to look down. John laughed even harder. I guess whoever built that trestle knew what they were doing, because we cruised over it without so much as a shimmy or a shake. I breathed a giant sigh of relief. Nothing was pushing us anymore. From here on, we went downhill by force of gravity. We were on top of the mountain ridge, descending at an easy rate of speed. Mr. Sherman told us we were traveling about 10 miles an hour. It wasn't long before we reached a place called 5 Mile Tree, where we crossed a short bridge that spanned a set of tracks below us. "We'll be going back to Mauchunk on those tracks," John told me, "and a little faster than now." Mount Jefferson rose about a mile in front of us. We came to a stop at the bottom, and once again got pushed to the top by a Barney car. We rode through another engine house and made an easy glide into Summit Hill. John and I jumped out and waved goodbye to Mr. Sherman. In a few minutes, we were at John's home. Chapter 18, Breaker Boys. "Mother, mother," John yelled as we approached his house in Summit Hill, "I've brought someone from Mauchunk." A slender woman with long reddish hair walked out of the house. She shielded her eyes from the sun and appeared quite curious to see who her son had brought home. "Mother, this is Finn Gorman," John said. "He's from downriver near Bethlehem. His father is a boat captain, and they came to Mauchunk on business." "Did you hear his last name, Mother? It's Gorman." "Yes, John," Miss Gorman said. "I did indeed. Come in, Finn. Welcome to our home. John seems quite excited to have you here." "Yes, ma'am," I replied. "I'm excited, too. I think we could be related." "Perhaps we are, Finn," Miss Gorman chuckled. "Let's sit down and talk. I'd like to learn more about you and your family." I told John's mother everything I could remember. The potato famine in Ireland, the trip across the Atlantic Ocean, living in New York, and coming to Pennsylvania and Fremansburg. Miss Gorman listened patiently and never interrupted my story. "Finn, we came here from Ireland too," she said when I was done. "My husband was a coal miner in a little town called Agrina, in the county of Roscommon. The potato famine affected us too, like it did your family. We left by ship from Dublin. Young John was a baby like you when we came over. I had another son, just like your mother has Colin, but he died on the way over. The trip across the ocean was too much for him. My husband Seamus refused to live in New York. There were gangs of thieves and thugs that roamed the streets and hurt people. They were always asking for money, but we had none to give them." Here's an illustration of a mule or a hinny pulling a load of coal from a mine. "We came directly to Pennsylvania after Mr. Gorman heard about the coal mines. He started as a laborer and never received a promotion. He is honest and works hard, but he's Irish, and a lot of people in these parts don't like us Irish. Mr. Gorman nor any of the other Irish workers in the mine will ever get a promotion. The boss loves the men as workers, but don't have much respect for them as people. But without the Irish, the mines would never produce coal, because no one else would do such dangerous work for so little pay. Look at poor John," she continued. "He lost a finger during an accident at the breaker house when he was only 8 years old. His father will not let him return. He is one of the few boys in Summit Hill who doesn't work at the colliery or the coal mine. Father wants me to get a good education so I don't have to work in the coal mine when I get older," John said. "My friends are all breaker boys. They work 12 to 15 hours a day, with only a short break for lunch. They cut their hands and break their fingers and sniff in coal dust until they cough. Some of them get sick but still have to work. And they only get paid a few pennies a day, John added. They don't like it, but they have to work because their fathers don't earn enough money for their families to survive. We survive because mother spends a few hours in the mine owner's house cooking for his family. She doesn't get paid much, but it helps. John was anxious to take me to the mine. I thanked Miss Gorman, and the next second, John and I were off like a shot for the switchback. When we got there, a line of empty coal cars was about to be pushed down a track headed for the Panther Valley. "Mr. Finney, can we jump in?" John shouted to a man working next to the track. "Sure, John," he called back. "Going to see your father, are you?" "Yes, Mr. Finney," John said. "I'll tell him you said hello." We jumped into a car just as it began to move. After a couple of miles, we came to a little village called Ashton. John asked Mr. Finney to slow the car so we could jump out. My attention was drawn to an ear-splitting noise coming from a tall wooden building near the railroad track. The noise was so loud that it shook the building. "What is that place?" I asked John. "It's the colliery," he said. "Most people call it the breaker house. It's where my friends work, and it's also where I lost my finger. Coal from the mine is taken in there and crushed with huge hammers. That's why it's so noisy." "Can we go in?" I asked. "No," John said, without hesitating. "The boss in there wouldn't like that, but we can peek in. Come with me, and be quiet." The air near the breaker house was filled with black dust. I coughed, and John gave me a handkerchief to put over my mouth and nose. We climbed on top of some wooden crates and peeked through a small, dirty window. I couldn't believe what I saw. There were 30 to 40 young boys inside sitting on little wooden planks. They were as crummy as could be, their clothes and hands and faces covered with thick black soot. Most of them wore handkerchiefs over their noses and mouths so they wouldn't breathe in the black dust that filled the air. The planks they sat on were arranged in neat rows over narrow wooden chutes that carried coal and other rocks that were crushed at the top of the breaker. They were all hunched over. No one looked from side to side. In the middle of everyone stood a nasty-looking man holding a thick stick. "Shh," John whispered. "That's the breaker boss. If one of those boys slows down or talks, the boss will hit them with that stick." And here you can see an illustration of that nasty-looking man, and you can see the rows of boys over the chutes, gray with coal dust. The breaker boy's job was to separate coal from waste rock, which John called coal. They'd let the coal slide down the chutes, but when a piece of coal came by, they would lower their feet into the chute to slow the whole pile. Then they'd pick out the coal and toss it into another chute that took it outside. The coal kept going and was sorted according to size. The boys' hands were in awful condition, but no one wore gloves. If they did, they wouldn't be able to pick out the coal as fast, and the boss would hit them for being too slow. Most of the boys were my age and even younger. "I think I've seen enough of this place," I told John. "Can we meet your father?" We jumped to the ground and ran to the mine. I don't know what I was expecting, but all I saw was a dark tunnel. I looked down, but it was pitch black. I couldn't see anything. All of a sudden, a mule came out of the tunnel, pulling a cart full of coal. I jumped back. Behind him was a man holding a whip and wearing a hat on his head that held a tiny lighted lantern. "Is the mine down there?" I asked John. "Of course it is," he laughed. "Mines aren't dug on top of the ground. The tunnel goes down hundreds of feet and goes off in all directions." "Is that all the light they have?" I said. "There are a few bigger lanterns, too," John replied, "but they still don't give off a lot of light. If your lantern goes out, you can't see your hand in front of your face. It's scary. Sometimes there are explosions down there if a lantern is lighted in a gas pocket. Then you have cave-ins. There are rats all over the place, too." I was watching the mule pull the cart of coal. A second man walked out of the tunnel. He was tall with a broad mustache and a pleasant smile. I knew immediately it was Mr. Gorman. He had an uncanny resemblance to Father. John introduced me and quickly told my story. "So, lad, you think we might be relatives," Mr. Gorman said. "It would be a fine thing, wouldn't it?" "Yes, sir, it would," I said. "I'd like to bring my family here someday." "And I'd like to meet them," Mr. Gorman replied. "I'm sure we'd have much to talk about. I hope to see you again, Finn, but now it's time for me to return to work." Mr. Gorman shook my hand and John and I jumped into a car full of coal that was being pulled to the switchback and then on to Mauchunk. The sun was getting lower in the sky. It was time I got back to the Belfast Queen. Miss Gorman was standing next to the railroad as we passed through Summit Hill. I waved and shouted to her that I would be back. As we left town, we passed the spot on the ground that was smoking. The air smelled like rotten eggs. "That's burning mine," John said. "It's been burning underground for years. No one knows when it will stop. There's always smoke and that foul smell. Hold on, Finn, the ride is going to get good. We should be in Mauchunk in about 30 minutes.
30 minutes?
I questioned, thinking John was joking. "It took us 3 hours to get here."
"I know," he said, "but it's all downhill. Hold on to your hat."
Our line of 8 cars was heavy with coal, and they had no problem gaining speed whenever the brakeman allowed. The coal shook and created clouds of black dust as we rumbled over the track. This was totally different than being pushed uphill by a Barney car. "I'll wager we were going 40 miles an hour," John yelled. I didn't answer. I just prayed we wouldn't go any faster. I could hear the brakeman laughing above all the noise of the cars. Listening to him, I feared my prayers would not be answered. Then I looked ahead and saw nothing but a long, straight line of track. "We're on the home stretch," John screamed. "It's 2 miles of straight track. Isn't this great?" All I could think about was the disrespectful boat captain and how green his face became after he ate the bear meat. I was sure that right now my face was much greener than that. Finally, I yelled at the top of my lungs, "When do we get to Mauchunk?" And here's a photo of Finn not looking very pleased, but his friend looking very excited. And with that, the car slowed down to a gradual, pleasing stop. In front of me, there were great coal chutes of Mauchunk. Behind me was a memory I would hold on to for more than one reason. "I hope you like the ride, Finn," John said. "We can do it again the next time you come here." I smiled and nodded my head. My face was black from coal soot, and I was as wobbly as a duck. I took a deep breath, shook the dust from my clothes, and walked over to John. "Thank you, John," I said. "This was the most marvelous day of my life, and the scariest." We both bent over laughing. John and I were both Gormans, but better than that, we had become true friends. I knew I would see him again. I walked back to the boat basin and told Father and Colin my story. It was a good day, one I would never forget. Well, that was exciting. Be sure to check out the follow-up information listed in this post, and come back on Monday to learn where Finn is headed next. See you next time, and have a great week.